Good afternoon, everyone. I think we'll get started. Thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Sarah Al-Sharawi. I'm the managing editor of Arab Media and Society, which is the journal of the research and publications division of the Adham Center under the leadership of Dr. Hussein Amin, who is joining us today as well. So for you, for those of you who don't know, the journal, which is available full text online, is a mixed publication. So we offer both peer-reviewed scholarship as well as a variety of other content, research, other research reporting, columns, and a podcast. And we also recently just expanded into Arabic. We have just published our second bilingual issue. Our first issue was published in the summer. It was on media and terrorism. And we just published our second issue, as I said, which was on media and culture. We're extremely pleased to have Dr. Hatsuki Aishima with us today. Dr. Aishima was a contributor to this last issue. And like I said, it's now available online. If you haven't done so already, you can pick up a copy of the table of contents, which is available on the tables outside, And today we have Dr. Aaron Morrison, who will act as a discussant for the lecture. And Dr. Morrison is assistant professor of sociology here at AUC, and also the director of the graduate program of sociology and anthropology. And with that, I'll hand it over to Ian to give a more extensive introduction of Dr. Hatsuki.
Hi, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Hatsuki Aishima and thank her for joining us today. We're very lucky to have the opportunity to hear her discuss her work. Dr. Aishima has a doctorate in Oriental Studies from Oxford and is now an associate professor at the National Museum of Ethnology in Osaka. Previously, she taught about modern Islam at the University of Manchester. The research she's going to talk about today is related to her doctoral thesis, which came to be published under the title Public Culture and Islam in Modern Egypt, Media, Intellectuals, and Society. The book is here at the front, and we can pass it around. It's available at the AUC bookstore, and it's also available online through the publisher, and there are discount flyers that are available at the desk outside. So I don't want to give away too much, but in broad strokes, the book discusses the relationship between, on the one hand, forms of mass media and modern education, and on the other, the public knowledge, scholarly culture, and literary tradition of Islam. Today, Hatsuki is going to be focusing particularly on this relationship with regard to the figure of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, the former Grand Imam of Al-Azhar. We'll hopefully have some time after the presentation for questions and discussion. So I will hand it over.
Okay, so thank you, Ian, and thank you, Sarah, for organizing this event. And I'm very happy to see all of you here today, because I've been doing this research for quite a while, but this is the first time that I get to give a presentation in Cairo, where I have been doing research for years, and I love the city. So before I start, how many of you have heard of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud? Excellent, this doesn't happen usually, I'm sorry. How many of you have read the books by Abdel-Halim Mahmoud? That's wonderful, okay. So the book is about the research, main part of the research is about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, but then a large part of the book is also about the people who knew Abdel-Halim Mahmoud or who like to talk about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud in one way or another. So I hope I can communicate the main points of my book as well as talk a little bit about the things that I couldn't include in the book today. So the title of the book is Public Culture and Islam in Modern Egypt. And public culture, so this is, I think, the kind of new concept in Middle East studies. And then I guess for those of you who study sociology or media studies, this is a known thing. So I want to start a little bit from that that point, right? So you can see from the cover of the book that this is a Fishawi in Khan Khalid, yes, Khan Fishawi. And then this is very iconic that this gentleman in a suit is reading Al-Haya, which is published in London. So the newspaper published in London, and this gentleman in a suit is reading in a coffee shop in Cairo. And then there's nothing special about it. This is a scene that we see on a day-to-day basis in Egypt. And I love to also go to coffee shop and read or talk to friends. And then the whole point of this, you know, the public culture is to see the ways in which the media has changed or shaped the people's relationship or the way that with which people feel the sense of connectedness, yes? So in the sense of that, I mean, there is, for instance, the concept of a ummah in Islamic theology. And everybody have know that in English you give a glossing like a community of believers. So idea of ummah has existed since the beginning of Islam to contemporary times. But then like if you're a scholar of anthropology or sociology, we can still think about, so by the introduction of new types of education, new types of media, how do people's imagination of a community have changed or have not changed in one way or another? So in a sense that this is a kind of issue that addressed by a sociologist and historian like Benedict Anderson or Jürgen Habermas, that by having a community, you know, like some public sphere in a sense of any space outside home, yes? If you say the private is the space inside home and the public is a space outside home, that when you step outside, that's the public, yes? But then in like medieval times when there was only like a space between like an work and home, and then when there was an introduction of the print in like 16th century Europe, and then there's the development of the coffee shop. The coffee was introduced through Ottoman Empire. And then like there's a kind of space where people gather outside home, but it's not work. And then people can talk about what they've read in a book, printed book or newspaper. And then by you're not meeting a people who's outside of your family or workspace, but then still talk about some same topic of what's going on in the politics or economics or literature, yes? And this is what Habermas means by the kind of public sphere, that although the people are not related maybe, you know, in kind of kinship sense or work sense, but still they feel some kind of sense of connectedness because they have read something. And then for us nowadays, this is so benign because we do this all the time, that you have not met Dr. Abdel-Halim Mahmoud in person, but you can sort of feel that you know about him or this is something related to do with Egypt or so, right? So, but my book traces the development of change in these people's sense of connectedness, right, in the sense of the public culture from 19th century when the print was late 18th century, print was introduced to Egypt to modern day times, that there's a new form like a satellite television and now the internet, so on and so forth. And Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is somebody from the age of print to radio and television because he's from the 60s and 70s. So, just to give you an overview, so who was Abdel-Halim Mahmoud and who is he, you know, to the Egyptian public? So, his books have been published kind of, many kind of outlets, but nowadays you probably have seen the version of the reprint of his book from Darul Ma'arif, yes? That's a national publishing house. And he has published many things about Sufism, Islamic philosophy, Islamic law, so on and so forth, you know. And then that's why he's known as the father of Sufism in modern age. So, and then he has a background of like studying at Azhar, but also studying in France. And then he eventually studied with a very famous French orientalist called Louis Massignon, and then wrote his PhD on Islamic mysticism. So that was his beginning of career, you know, in Sufi studies or Islamic mysticism. And then he was somebody who's very much concerned of educating the Egyptian public to Islamic subject. Because we are talking about the 50s and 60s under the socialist Nasser's period, that the people many Egyptians didn't think Islam was something so important for their identity. Or like as an educated person, you didn't really need to know about Islam, but you might know about engineering or medical science or literature, but not Islam. But Abdel-Halim Mahmoud always felt passionate about educating the public about the knowledge of Islam, especially Sufism and Islamic philosophy. So the reason why he's, I think, Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is still known nowadays is that he was very concerned of talking about Islam on media, like radio, or publishing the newspaper articles or even the magazine articles about this subject, yes? So that's why some of the people I met during my field research between 2006 and 8 recall him as the kind of radio star of the 60s and 70s. Maybe for you now, you know, for that you don't listen to radio very often, but from the people of the generation of the 60s, 70s, radio was a very important medium of entertainment, yes? So, and then so that's why the older generation, people who are in their 50s or 60s, they think of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud as somebody from that time of radio. And then, yes, he eventually became the Grand Imam of Azhar Mosque University during the Sadat period. So, just to give you a very wide overview of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's life as a scholar and as an educator. So this is a photo of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud from his young age. Probably these are the passport photos, yes? From the young age that he went to France to like towards end. And then this is a photo taken from the website called Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's organization, so you can look up and see all sorts of photos of him. But I love this series, that how like he had sort of his sort of fashion sense, fashion dress code had changed over time, yes? And then for me, this was quite crucial because yeah, I think this represent his change in fashion dress code, represent his the change in his ideas, and also about how he's sort of representing himself to the public. So Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, as I told you, he's somebody who's educated in Azhar system, and then he went to France, and he comes back and was working, teaching at Azhar, teaching like a psychology, philosophy, so on and so forth, yes? And then he did study Sufism in France, you know, as a kind of subject, oriental studies. However, he says in his autobiography that he didn't have like a Sufism as a kind of upbringing. So that's why when he went to France and met Massignon and studied Sufism, that was the first formal encounter with Sufism he ever had, right? But then somehow, you know, he started to look for a Sufi master after he returned to Cairo. And then eventually meet one in 1960. And then it's quite you know, amazing that he was sort of interested or like got attracted to Sufism in this context of socialist time where people didn't really care about, you know. They've been Muslim, but they didn't really think about like finding a sheikh is something important. So he meets the Sufi master, and then in 1961, the Azhar was nationalized, like many institutions in Egypt those days. And then as a kind of reaction to this nationalization of Azhar in 1961, Abdel-Halim Mahmoud changes his dress code. So previously, he went to France when he was kind of effendi style, and then he was still wearing his suit after he came back to Egypt, which was kind of a strange thing, that everybody in Azhar was dressed in the kaftan and turban, whereas Abdel-Halim Mahmoud was in this fancy suit. And then as a reaction to Nasser's nationalization of Azhar, he changed his dress code to this sort of the Azharite, what we nowadays would think as Azharite look, to show that this is how the proud you know, Islamic scholar, Muslim scholar would look like, yes? So there's, and then not only, you know, changing his dress code, but he also changed the way he write. So previously he wrote more when he was in this kind of European suit. He used to write more for the scholarly community, and he was concerned like doing orientalist work, like critical edition of Sufi classics, translation of French work to Arabic, and then so on and so forth. But since finding the Sufi master and then changing his dress code, he started to write more for the general public. So his writing style changes. and also the content, you know, kind of the things. He writes more about the biographies of Sufi figures to show that there's a Sufism is rooted to Islamic tradition, and also Sufism can bring something meaningful to Egyptian society. So, and then the part of my work is also concerned about the legacies of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. So Abdel-Halim Mahmoud passed away in 1978. However, his sort of legacy lingers in contemporary society. And that is really, you know, what interests me quite a lot. So, I mean, Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is a generation from Kulthum, Abdel-Halim Hafiz, Sheikh Sharawi, and but you know that most of the time, like when people hear the name Abdel-Halim, people think about Abdel-Halim Hafiz, yes? So when you Google Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, like, half of the thing, or like, I don't know, three-fourths is Abdel-Halim Hafiz, and there's something about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. So, yeah, so like, but then there are people who still feel very passionate about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work or his radio recordings. And then that really fascinated me when I first visited Egypt for my research in year 2001, yes? That there seemed to be a like, very big gap between how I read Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work and how Egyptian fans, not everybody's fan, they can be critical of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work, but how the people in Egypt read or appreciate his work. And then I have, when I looked at the sort of series of his publication, I noticed that the works that were published during his lifetime, usually the cover just comes with the title of the book, yes, and his name. But then the books that were published afterwards, they have his photo, and then like the one, this orange one on your side, left side. That, yeah. Photo, and then sometimes even address like Arif Billah, so like the knower of God, yes? Which is quite a fascinating transformation from that being a scholar and to suddenly that there's somebody who's like even like a knower of God, yes, at one point of his life. And then this transformation takes place from like after he passed, a few years after he passed away, and then gradually increases, and then to the extent that in 2008 there was a TV series made out of his life during the Ramadan. And I don't know if any of you had a chance to watch, but yeah, there are so many TV shows during Ramadan, and then I'm very aware that I was only one of the few people who was interested in this subject. And that's why I was avidly watching this show, but not many of my Egyptian friends were watching it. But anyhow, yeah, that he started as a scholar, and then so for some Egyptians, some segments of Egyptian society, he's now like assumed a role like an artist, that something very special, yes. But then at the same time, it's not like he had a disciples himself, yes. But he didn't have so many murid. He was not the sheikh. Murshid of any particular Sufi order, but he assumed this kind of almost like sheikh-like aura to some people. But although everybody know Abdel-Halim Mahmoud through his publication from radio, it's not like the traditional style of Sufi training that you actually meet your master. But his sort of training takes place through books and radio, which again raises a very interesting question from the kind of classical Sufi studies perspective. So what I did, as I told you earlier, the large part of my research was between 2006 and 2008. For 2.5 years, I lived in downtown Cairo, and then did all sorts of things. But then you boil it down to 3 points, would be like the first thing is that I tried to meet the readers of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, whoever said they have read the book or bought his book, or I don't know. Says like they know about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, and then I read the book of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud with my friends, basically. Also, I spoke with the people who knew Abdel-Halim Mahmoud in person, and this is has been a very kind of rich and an interesting experience as well, right? And then, and also I visited Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's library. So Abdel-Halim Mahmoud passed away in Cairo, but his books are collected by his family members and kept in his native village. So there's a huge library with over 5,000 books. And then I also visited the place. And then I, yes, maybe, you know, if you are interested in these things, please visit, because he has a very good collection of books, but nobody's using it in his village, Karyat Salam, in the base. So there's a pigeon living there, and I was very shocked about it. But, and I was very shocked, yes, because I'm a scholar, and I think the books are sacred, you have to keep books in a good place. And, but the family member said, ah, there's a pigeon, let's take a photo. So that's me taking photo in a kind of a timid way, yeah, with the books of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. So these are the kind of basically the methodology that I took, and I call it an ethnological approach to modern Islamic thought. And then because I'm raising two problems, yes? So one problem is that for scholars who study modern Islamic thought, they think that reading text is the main thing, yes? So it's, you don't even have to state. Of course, you know, Abdel-Halim Mahmoud has written like so many books. Why don't you stay in Oxford and read his books? Yeah, that's the approach. So like one of my supervisors even said when I said I want to go to Cairo and read the books of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud with his fans, you know, and then they would say like, well, but they might lie to you. And yes, they might lie to me, but you know, that's not the whole point. That the point is that I go to Egypt and I want to gain the appreciation that the Egyptians have. And on the other hand, so this is a problem that the anthropologists, I think some anthropologists who work on Islam would all share, is that many anthropologists are almost illiterate, yes? They don't read. As if like everybody is working in some sort of illiterate society, even they're working in contemporary society. You know, the many scholars who work on the Middle East, anthropologists, they don't think it's important to read the text. So from the perspective of Islamic studies, I stress that you have to decenter the role of text. So text is important, but you also need to know how this text is read. But for the perspective of anthropology, I want to stress that it's also important to bring some text in, as in the Talal Asad discussed about the Islam's discursive tradition. So if the people we study about are reading things, you know, in the 21st century, most people are illiterate, and they're reading texts, you know, whether as a book form or Twitter or, you know, on the internet or maybe through the television, whatever, but they are texts, so why don't we engage with this to some extent in the kind of ethnographic, taking ethnographic approach. So that's the main point of my theoretical problem that I'm addressing in my book throughout. And you can ask me more questions later on this problem, yeah. So overall, I address in my book, Public Culture and Islam in Modern Egypt, that about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, but also after lives of his work, yes? So that what happens, you know, that the author writes a book and finishes, and when the book leaves her or him, you know, there's a book has another life, yes, on its own. Like for instance, you know, that I published this book. This book came out last summer, basically, like June 2016, and this was the first time that I see my book sold in a bookstore. Yes, so I came to Cairo and went to book Cairo Book Fair, and I was very happy to find a copy of my book displayed. Yes, you know, and I even told the people who are selling the book, this is me, and they're like, yeah, whatever, you know. But this is kind of the excitement that you have, yes, that my book was displayed together with the books on biography, yes, not just Islam, but biography, and together in the same shelf as Elvis and religion. Yes? So if you look for my book, it's in the biography section next to Elvis and religion. So again, you know, but this is something that I don't expect, yes, I didn't expect at all when I started the project, that how this book will market it and be read or like be sold. So my book sort of traces this sort of metamorphosis of ideas as well as the material life of ideas. And then one of the key words I address in my book is that the idea of uslub, in Arabic, and for Arabic speakers, it's like something that you know all the time, but people talk about the style of expression method of doing something, you know. And then this was a key word for me to make me understand why Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is special to certain Egyptians, is that from a study intellectual history perspective, we look at the originality of intellectual's work, right? So what is special about this writing, right? But then when I was first reading Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work in Oxford, I couldn't really see what was special, because he obviously writes about the very mundane things about Islamic faith and what to be a good Muslim, yes? And then I couldn't quite understand sort of why this publication could be so special that it's reprinted and then here's a fan. And then many of my friends who I read the book together told me that because Abdel-Halim Mahmoud had a good uslub, a good style of writing. And I think that's very much the key when we look at the work of public intellectuals, meaning that the intellectuals who write for the members of general public, educated, but maybe not specialists, yes? But we have that probably the same experience in writing for our community, for scholars, and writing for the general public is two different, work, yes? And that's what Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is basically doing, or he did, when he was writing since the 60s, that he was writing for the educated, but not yet specialist public. So he would, but that doesn't mean that he's not writing, delivering any special knowledge, yes? But then whatever the precious message that he had put in his writing had to be framed in a way that the educated Egyptians can appreciate. So, and then, I had this inspiration when I spoke with the scenario writer of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud serial. Then he said, I asked him, so what do this, many Egyptians mean by Abdel-Halim Mahmoud has a good uslub, or so-and-so doesn't have a good uslub, whatever, so on and so forth. And then Bahiddin Ibrahim told me that, well, Islam is like a cake. Yes, I like this expression, that Islam is like a cake, so it's after all, you're making a pastry. But then you use the same ingredients, like flour and egg and sugar, yes? So that's why, if you are sort of writing something in the Islamic studies genre, obviously you quote from the Quran and Hadith and prophetic biography. So these ingredients don't differ. But if the person who is reading, or at the receiving end of the message, is somebody who is educated or familiar with the subject, then you can see the difference. So the content is the same, the elements are the same, but by adjusting the content a little bit, you can deliver your own ideas. And then from my research of talking to my Egyptian friends, I think that's what many of my friends were doing, when they were analyzing the writing of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, or listening to the radio recording with me, that they are trying to analyze, see what the, it's not about the originality of his ideas, but they say that what Abdel-Halim Mahmoud says is correct and sound, and therefore there's a value in listening to his speech. So overall, the goal of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud was to do some, what I call the Sufi dawah. So he wanted to educate the non-educated people of Egypt that the Sufism is not a sort of tradition alien to Islam, but it's a sort of spiritual tradition firmly rooted to Islamic law and Sunnah. And then he also presents Sufism in a way that it is a method of acquiring divine knowledge, yes? But he doesn't say that, he says that it's not like mysticism in European sense. He actually used the word mysticism, right? He said it's not like tasawuf, it's about mysticism. It's not about mysticism, or it's not just aestheticism, yes? But it is you can be a Sufi, but still be socially, economically productive individual. So he, for Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, Sufism is, I mean, undoubtedly, Islamic tradition, but also it's not about being just a spiritual, in the sense of like you keep your faith in a private sphere, but you can still be productive and work hard and be good to the nation and so on and so forth. And that was his message, yes? And then what I see from maybe the recent reception of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work, people who read Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work would say that they think of Sufism is like a high culture, and then or more than like a private faith. So they, although Abdel-Halim Mahmoud presented in his writing about Sufism as a practice, right, his individual, his encounter with the Sufi master and what he used to do and this miraculous experience he had. But then I think many readers sort of don't think that's an important part of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's writing, but then they still appreciate Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's work, but in a sense of more like a Sufism as a private faith or like a high culture, in a sense that his work is still being read and appreciated, but in a slightly different way, I think, from what Abdel-Halim Mahmoud had intended. And then his Musalso from 2008 is a very good example to see that how his idea has been reproduced in different way, but still been appreciated in contemporary Egypt. Okay, thank you.
So there's a lot of rich material that we could get into and have a discussion about. So we'll open the floor to questions, but I just want to flag a few areas where we could possibly begin a discussion. Areas or questions or thoughts. One could be how the method of conveying messages changes based in or in relation to social change. The second, memory or the familiarity and its relation to the translation or the absorption of thought. Third one could be the formation and transformation of publics. And the last is the methodological question that Hatsuki brought up about the relationship of ethnography and ideas, or ethnography and text. So, first one, how the method of conveying messages changes in relation to social change. So, I mean, these are broad areas and people can ask questions related to them or unrelated, as you wish.
Thank you for the talk. I don't know anything about this, but you mentioned during your talk that you were surprised when you were reading his book with Egyptian friends, how different they approached the book compared to you. Can you say a little bit more about that? Like, what do you think the actual difference is and why, like, what factor caused that difference? Is it just because you were a researcher, or like, do you think there's something they see or that they don't see? Do you mind elaborating a little bit about that?
Okay, that's, I think, a good point to start. One thing we need to bear in mind in doing research about other cultures, other countries, is that obviously, Abdel-Halim Mahmoud didn't write this for me, a Japanese scholar, coming to do research in Egypt in year 2000. Yes, so he wrote for the people who lived with him in 1960s and 70s. So, and then what? But then, in practical sense, what difference would it make? Yes, is that I think the kind of the knowledge you have about the society and social change, your current affairs. That is one very important factor to think, because when I read this Abdel-Halim's work in relation to what has been published in intellectual history works, mainly written in English or in Japanese. Whereas, like, I think my Egyptian friends, they read different things, so they are more aware of what Abdel-Halim Mahmoud might be suggesting in the context of the 70s, the social change, or that just the general knowledge that Abdel-Halim Mahmoud might have referred to in a different program or so, yes? So they have like a more knowledge about Egypt and about Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. And then also, like linguistically as well, that for me, I read and I understand the meaning. But then I gradually been educating my friends to like look at the little kind of linguistic changes, you know, that Abdel-Halim Mahmoud makes. For instance, one scholar from Azhar who specialized in theology was very sure that Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's writing was rubbish. Because if you are a scholar, he said you have to write, you know, when you start writing, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and you have this solution, and then you go like, Amma bad fa, yes? Now, and you deliver the main topic. But Abdel-Halim Mahmoud just has a very kind of short beginning, solution, and then you have a, like, wabad fa, wabad. Yes, and then for me, it's like one about four or about it's the same. You address the topic and you read the main topic. But then for some people, it's very important that you have this full-on solution before starting the main text. And then, so this small thing, details, I would not have known unless I came here.
We don't like the cake, this cake.
They didn't like this cake, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so this cake is for different audience, not for this Azhari scholar.
Okay, thank you.
I want to draw a parallel between Abdel-Halim Mahmoud and his story and a much earlier Imam Muhammad Abdu. Now, Muhammad Abdu, and I think you're going to find it in all Islamic scholars, that they have a trend of Sufism in it. Muhammad Abdu was also a Sufism. Muhammad Abdu, 20, 30 years after his death, many of the people in Egypt did not recognize who's Muhammad Abdu, to the extent that one of his students, who was Sheikh Al-Azhar then, Mustafa Abdul Razak, had to give lectures to tell people who Muhammad Abdu is. What I'm trying to tell you is this: the story keeps repeating itself. I could go even much earlier. There was an imam, and he was also a Sufi, Laith ibn Sa'd. And Imam Shafi'i says Laith ibn Sa'd was more scholar or more knowledgeable than Malik, but his students failed him because they did not manage. I don't know, is it just something that keeps perpetuating? This is one question. The second thing is that when you talk about Sufism, at least the Egyptian brand of Islamic, which is very different than the current one, which tends to be more Wahhabi, you're going to find that Sufism is very subtle in the way they do things and the way they think. This is not mysticism. This is how they are brought up. I mean, in every village, there is sort of a master. There is somebody with a Sufism inclination, and they work. They are regular people. They're not like... You see what I'm trying to say? Am I getting my point?
Yeah, so you mean like they're not... So you're saying that not all Sufis are like a large, for instance, right?
Yes.
Yeah, like how it's presented in Orientalist work, that the Sufism in Egypt is more kind of lifestyle.
Yes.
And then, yes. I think that Abdel-Halim Mahmoud Sufism is a combination of the two, that in a sense that the... He is, yes, indeed, against this kind of orientalist representation of Sufism as this kind of mystics who are just doing spiritual whatever. But then he's also not so happy with just people who are Sufi because they're brought up in Sufi way. So because he, at least for himself, you know, that he, for him it was very important that the Sufism was a kind of conscious decision, that he looked for a master and he has found one. And for him, that was important, that it's not just the family upbringing, but it's sort of him, his sort of individual sort of effort and, exploration as a Muslim to find the master. But I think the comparison with Muhammad Abdu would be quite interesting. I don't know to what extent that Abdel-Halim Mahmoud's legacy would linger on like how Abdu is now. And then it will be interesting to see, because I think Muhammad Abdu as well, that there has been a quite a long time that he was not being sort of become so important to Egyptian public, but I noticed that in the last 10, 15 years that there have been more and more books written on Mohamed Abdu. To the extent a few years ago, I saw on the Cairo International Book Fair poster, there was Abdu as a main figure. So I was really shocked a bit with this sort of revival of Abdu's legacy. So yeah, so let's see what is going to happen to Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I mean, this is quite a very important theme. I'm interested in this. I have actually worked on medical anthropology here, and I touched upon issues of Sufism. And I would actually just, you know, follow up the issue that Ali has raised with regard to this, the role of Sufism in Egyptian society. Across time. Mohamed Abdu is a figure, and there's another figure called Khattab al-Sabki also, who used to be a figure also. Mohamed Abdu and Khattab al-Sabki used to have it be Sufis, and Sufism is actually an integral part of Muslim faith. It's not actually something that characterizes people. Many, many people, many scholars have been Sufis, including Mohamed Abdu and many others. Khattab al-Sabki and Mohamed Abdu, nevertheless, played significant social and political roles in society. Khattab al-Sabki's legacy is still on. You know, hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Egyptians are influenced by his work through the Jama'iyya al-Muhammadiyya, al-Amirin fi Sharia al-Muhammadiyya. Now, it's actually, with regard to the work of Talal Asad also, this issue of the role of Sufism and the role of religion and the role of the Sharia also has actually evolved through time. It really strikes me the difference between privatization and public role of religion, that, you know, Asad's themes is actually in the 19th century and early 20th century, there was a travel. Religion has traveled from the public sector. It has been privatized. And the best example for that is the family law, قانون الأحوال الشخصية. Now, nevertheless, Mohamed Abdu and the movement that followed resisted that. There was a public role for religion. But with with Abdel-Halim, I can see that there is a movement toward privatization, which is represented by, you know, Sufism. And you, I think, to my taste, it's actually an emerging role of Sufism that is westernized. I mean, this issue of calling Sufism mysticism is, I think, a mistake, is a bad translation. To what extent can you actually encounter this argument that actually what happened in the 60s and 70s was a continued westernization of Muslim tradition rather than going back to, yeah, that's my very brief question. I'm sorry to be late, to be too long, yeah.
Important and interesting question whether Abdel-Halim Mahmoud is bringing in this sort of Orientalist take on Sufism to Egyptian public, or he is trying to go back to whatever he thinks as an kind of original Islamic tradition on Sufism. Yeah, and I think what is important here is that it's neither one or the other, you know. I think that is what is happening is in the case of Abdel-Halim Mahmoud, that obviously he is presenting Sufism, his branch of Sufism, as something original to Sunnah and then the early phase of Islam. And then that's how he represent. But where he got this idea is clearly through his intellectual scholarly training. So that had also influenced. So and then obviously, you know, we are talking about the 50s and 60s and all this globalization ideas and ideas flow, yes? And he is somebody who Abdel-Halim Mahmoud read and he criticizes Sartre in his work, yes? So he reads French and he was reading French philosophy. And then so he's very conscious of the kind of European take on Islam. He's not happy with it. That's why he presents Islam as something different. But he's doing this because he's aware of the sort of what he thinks kind of European invasion of thought. Yeah. So I think we're talking about some like Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. It's nonsense to try to separate one of the other. And I think it's the same work has been done by Mark Sedgwick on Muhammad Abdu. That Mark Sedgwick tried to show, you know, that it's not one or the other, but Abdu shows Abdu is aware of the Western intellectual tradition of the current affairs, and then he's writing about Islam for the Egyptians. Yeah, and I think very similar things is happening in Abdel-Halim Mahmoud. That we cannot assess to what extent he was which Europeanized or not Europeanized, Egyptian. But he's moving this very, very carefully between these two boundaries, and to produce something authentic to the people of the time. Yeah.
Actually a discursive practice when, you know, that I think there must be some room. I'm not actually, you know, criticizing your work or whatever, but I'm actually suggesting that might be worth looking at that effort, that conscious effort.
I have actually recently, the publication is coming out now on this issue, and to what extent he was conscious, or where is the role of the self in this Halim discussion of Sufi conversion. Why is it for him it's important that it's not something that he's been brought up with? Right, but then why it's important for him that it's like his Sufism, encounter to Sufism is related to Western tradition that he had been trained in. It's very important for him to sort of separate the two and try to construct something that is authentic to him. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, we have time for one last very brief question.
Well, I must confess, it's not so much a question, but just a comment, that what I think you might say symbolizes what you just were saying a minute ago is that on one hand, it's precisely Louis Massignon who says to him, what are you coming to the Sorbonne to study Islamic philosophy when you come from a religion that has the most extraordinarily developed spiritual system or methodology of spirituality, Sufism? And that's on one hand, it's Massignon, this extraordinary, who of course we know mostly for his work on Halaj, who puts him in that direction. But then when you read Abdel-Halim writing about what happens when he starts to read the Sufi masters, he has experiences that, I mean, everyone now seems to be speaking badly about mysticism, but I mean that one would in the West describe as mystical experiences. We could say, we wouldn't use that in Sufism, we would say rather that these were moments of, there's a whole Sufi vocabulary to describe what happens to him, but he encounters encounters more than texts and words. He encounters phenomena, you know, that is the only way we can talk about it. He experiences the presence of God. He experiences the presence of the writers. So he has two experiences, on one hand, as an alternative to growing up and where Sufism is part of village life, you know, the tariqa you're in is the tariqa your family was in. So on one hand, he comes to France as the great, brilliant young scholar who's going to do Islamic philosophy, and it's a brilliant Orientalist who says, look at Sufism. And then on the other hand, he has the sort of experience that Sufism is all about. In other words, I mean, Sufism plays played, I don't know if it still does, I hear it's under great difficulty with the young, but Sufism, of course, has social dimensions and familial dimensions and structural dimensions, but ultimately it is the the experience of experiencing the presence of God in this lifetime, and he has that, and it's very clear from his writing.
And I think, yeah, that just to add to one more point that I forgot to tell you, that yeah, I think Abdel-Halim Mahmoud has a problem with sort of the what is called like a tasawwuf Islami type approach, which was became very vogue in Egypt, especially like 60s and 70s, yes, that as a kind of Islamic Sufism, that this is too much intellectualization, because it's a kind of combination of European approach and then sort of Egyptian take on this, or it's a hyper-scientified approach to Sufism. And Abdel-Halim Mahmoud clearly has a problem with it, right? Because he, at the end, you know, he says, this experience is quite important. Although we don't know how you experience by reading a book, but yeah, for him it's the that you feel the divine, and the Sufism is a method to reach the higher knowledge. Yes, so that is the goal, and then if you just intellectualize it and make it a kind of private faith, then the whole point is gone. That, yeah. So that's his critique, I think, on the South Islam.
Well, I think that's all the time we have. People need to go to class, and so I think we'll stop it there. Thank you all very much for coming. If you, yes. if you would like to subscribe to for regular updates from the journal, you can visit us at arabmediasociety.com, and we have a subscribe button there so you can get regular updates about a publication, a call for papers, and so on. And please join me again in thanking Dr. Aishima for her insightful lecture.